in the center, so don't worry about what I'm doing.
Good evening. I'm Wayne McIntosh, the interim dean in the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences and professor emeritus in the Department of Government and Politics. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to this year's Feller Lecture. It's the third annual so far. We are excited and grateful to be able to gather in person, it's been a while, as a community, for this signature college event. We also have a number of participants, audience participants, who are online, so welcome to you as well. The Feller Lecture was established with the generous support of our distinguished alumni, Joel and Kim Feller. Joel is a member of the university's Board of Trustees and also is the 2016 recipient of the BSOS Alumnus of the Year Award. Joel and Kim have made transformational contributions to our college, recently established the Feller Center for Advising and Career Planning in Tidings Hall. Joel and Kim are here with us tonight. Please join me in thanking the Fellers for their unwavering support of our college and the University of Maryland. Thank you. Joel and Kim's vision for the Feller Lecture was to give the university community, and especially students, access to the insights of leading politicians, policymakers, political scientists, and thought leaders. Past speakers include Chuck Todd, host of Meet the Press, and our BSOS alum, Congressman Eric Swalwell of California. Tonight, we will be treated to an outstanding discussion of the current American political landscape, identity politics, and possibilities for bipartisanship, which seems a tall order these days. Now my honor to introduce you to our distinguished guests for the 2022 Feller Lecture. Tom Perez is a former U.S. Secretary of Labor, former Assistant Attorney General for Civil Rights, former chair of the Democratic National Committee. He also served as a professor at the University of Maryland Francis King Carey School of Law and is a senior fellow in international public affairs at Brown University. He's a graduate of Brown University and earned a JD from Harvard Law School, Master of Public Policy degree from the Harvard Kennedy School. Secretary Perez is the son of immigrants from the Dominican Republic, and in his long and distinguished career in law and in public service, he's worked to protect and expand opportunity and justice for all Americans. Secretary Perez is joined on stage by one of our outstanding faculty members in the Department of Government and Politics, Dr. Chryl Laird. Professor Laird is an alum of our Department of African American Studies and our Department of Government and Politics. I remember her as an undergraduate. I do. She earned her MA and PhD in political science from The Ohio State University. And prior to joining us as an assistant professor last fall, she held faculty positions at St. Louis University and Bowdoin College. Her work in American politics focuses on race and ethnic politics and political psychology. Dr. Laird's research examines the importance of Black political discourse in opinion formation and racial group norms. She also examines the interwoven nature of racial and gender identities for Black women and how it results in political engagement and partisanship. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Perez and Professor Laird as they begin our program.
Thank you all for being here. I have prepared a few questions for tonight, but we will also be reading some questions that were submitted in advance during registration. We will not be taking live questions tonight, and we would like to thank you, the students, alumni, and friends who submitted these engaging questions. All right, so out the gate here. The first question that we have is, there are ongoing public debates around free speech, racism, and sexism on college campuses. What approaches to addressing these issues do you find most compelling today?
Well, I think these are really, really important questions. And every college campus, every workplace, needs to create a climate of inclusion, a climate that ensures that every person here feels that they're valued, that their voice is valued, their experience is valued, and their opinions are valued. I remember when I was an undergrad at Brown, we had a speaker in 1982. His name was William O. Casey. He was the head of the CIA. Ronald Reagan was president. And this doesn't relate to the issues of race and sex, but it relates to the issue of free speech. And he was in a hall about this big, actually, Alumni Hall. I remember it vividly. And I always like to go to hear speakers where my instinct was I was going to disagree with everything they had to say, because I didn't want to just go see people who would reinforce my preconceived notions. I really wanted to hear folks who I thought were very different. And in the middle of that speech, a number of students got up and substantially disrupted it to the point where it was over. I fundamentally disagreed with that approach because they deprived me of my ability to hear him out. And their point was the things that he's advocating are so untenable that he's forfeited the privilege of coming and speaking at the university. Again, I categorically reject that proposition. And one thing I hope happens here, and you know, my first semester I taught at Brown, the person I recruited to become a senior fellow next term was Michael Steele. Now, Michael and I see the world differently in material respects. We have a genuine friendship. Life is the search for Venn diagrams, that common ground. And the reason I recruited Michael, and we did a number of things together at Brown, was because I was concerned that there was, you know, frankly, a culture of political correctness that made it difficult to hear perspectives. And one of the things that we did was we met with the young Dems and the young Republicans on campus one day for lunch. And it was a really interesting discussion. What I found most disappointing about it is it's the first time they'd ever come together in the same room. And so I think it's really important for us to create that space. I worked for a guy named Ted Kennedy years ago, and his capacity to build friendships with people who were not his ideological brothers and sisters, but were frankly quite different, his capacity to find that common ground was very real. Now, that's one aspect of your question. The other aspect is the issue of making sure we are building, again, climate. That's a word that I always use. When I go into an employer, when I was labor secretary, when I was at Brown, when I was at UMB at the law school, I was always mindful of climate. Climate has a number of different aspects to it. It does your workforce reflect the diversity of your university? diversity broadly defined? Do we have policies in place that are designed to make sure that we are living our values? And those are easier said than done. The answer is, well, we should do that, but the challenge is, what does it look like? And every college campus, it seems, or many college campuses, are frequently dealing with this. And this will be an iterative process, especially now in this world of, don't say gay. I mean, I would not want to be in a public university in the state of Florida right now, because I think the climate that has been created by the governor there is a climate of massive intolerance. And it is really, really problematic. We're hearkening back to the whole, this is not a new moment in American history. If you're wondering, like, oh my God, no, we can study the Know Nothing movement. We can study all sorts of movements where book banning was, that dates back, I think, to this, probably the 17th century, something like that. Historians will correct me and probably tell me it was the 16th. So the more things change, the more they stay the same. But we have to, and this is where leadership comes in. We really have to make sure, as deans and professors and every level of the university, we are working hard to create that culture of inclusion, that culture that will make everybody feel like there's a place for me here. I don't have to self-censor. I don't have to, but at the same time, I want to be respectful of what I am saying. I used to teach, at the law school, and I would teach, when I would teach on affirmative action, it was really hard if the class was almost all white and you're teaching Fourth Amendment stuff. It's a harder class to teach when you don't have diversity. And that's why one of the things that, and I'm getting a little afield here, but one of the things that worries me most right now about this Supreme Court is they are poised to overturn. We're waiting for Roe v. Wade. That's inevitable. And the next one to drop is going to be the Grutter framework. And I worked very hard on that 10 years ago when I led the Civil Rights Division. And that was a really, really critical framework that enabled us to build that climate, mm-hmm. and the student body that would enable us to, I think, be really strong. And the reason why this was so important is I remember vividly having a number of students of color having spirited discussions about Fourth Amendment issues. And it was really important, because this notion that there may be one opinion within, Latinos, when I was the first Latino elected to the county council, what do Latinos think about this? As if there's one answer to that question. It was kind of a stupid question, quite frankly. Anyway, I've gone on long enough, but I really think the climate is the key here. And I hope that if you're on the young R's, you will next week call the young Democrats, or if you're in the young Democrats, or if you're in, DSA or whatever you belong to, I hope that you will make it an effort to talk to someone who you may think, I can't find common ground with that person. This is what a campus is about, that search for that common ground, the search for the tools that will enable you to at least engage in that search. We've gotten really bad, and the adults are not modeling right now very well.
Absolutely. And I mean, I agree a lot of this of what you're saying here, because I too teach a course right now even on women of color in politics, and we just had a unit where we talked about Candace Owens and Nikki Haley and Condoleezza Rice, and many of my students were like, we are really appreciative that you brought in a variety of perspectives when it comes to women of color in politics, and the importance of diversity in the classroom and in the classroom space. And so I think that really dovetails nicely then to the second question, because it thinks about this idea of college access. success and barriers to college. And you already talked about the framework with Grutter and the affirmative action, but you know, it still remains a problem. And especially for Black and Latino and Indigenous communities, as well as some Asian American communities, you know, what are some of the most important considerations that we need to be aware of about this issue? And additionally, you know, to what degree do we need to consider things like standardized testing, SATs, LSATs, GREs, as potential barriers, right, and hurdles that are preventing many students from being able to access the collegiate environment?
Well, you know, one of the things that's going on here in Maryland, which is really exciting, is the blueprint for educational reform, which was enacted recently, and the next governor is going to be implementing. And the reason I start there is because the genius of this blueprint, and we should thank, among others, Britt Kerwin for his leadership in this, is that it recognizes that your question is a question that needs to, the focus needs to begin at cradle and go through career. You look at what happens to so many kids of color by the time you're entering preschool or kindergarten, and already behind the eight ball. And so I think we have to start early and understand that these investments in early childhood, these investments in educational equity, you know, my kids are proud graduates of the Montgomery County Public Schools. We are very satisfied customers. And I was really proud when I was on the county council to work there. But I recognize that there are way too many people who didn't have our experience. And so many of those people who didn't have our experience are families of color. And so that is part of this, because if we're not building the pipeline, then we're not doing our job. And that's where that starts. One of the lemonade moments out of the pandemic, in my opinion, was when y'all went SAT, ACT optional. Because I have always been dubious. Like, the LSAT measures how you will perform in your first year of law school. I would prefer, and I worked in admissions for a little while at Maryland Law School, I'd prefer to figure out who's going to make a difference. Look at the mission statement. You want people who are going to be effective business leaders and effective participants in civic life, who are going to make our communities better. And you know how you did in torts does not correlate with what you're going to do in life. And I've been really heartened by the data, at least the preliminary data that I've seen, about what's happened with schools that have gone SAT, ACT optional. And I personally hope that that is expanded to include GRE, LSAT, MCAT, and other. We're going to have a lot of data, because the UC system is ahead of the curve on this. And if we really want to address the diversity issues, I think this is something that we should really, really focus on. I love the community college system. Mm-hmm. And I know that so many community colleges in this state have been a pipeline for diversity here at College Park. And I think one of the things we need to do is to continue to support those initiatives. And we also need to, my sister used to work at Boston College in a program called the Ahana program. It was a program, you know, Boston College is pretty white, and they understood that, and they were trying to build a more diverse student body. But you can't pluck someone in who, you know, has, you know, had a lot of challenges and has incredible potential, so you want that student on campus and not support them. And so Maryland, I know, recognizes this, having spoken with your esteemed dean over there, Catherine. And, you know, those are things that we have to continue to redouble our efforts, because retention, and the first two questions are really interconnected.
They are.
And the retention is going to be a function of the climate. Mm-hmm. And if you're constantly looking around a room and you're not seeing a lot of people that look like you, you're going to feel isolated. And that's why we have to build critical mass. And when we invest in the blueprint and we have more kids from all corners of the state who are going to be coming here and thriving here, that's going to be the definition of success. And this university system can play a critical role in making that work.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think sometimes people often forget, right, that there is this kind of pipeline effect, right, that it is this factor of things that we can really consider early on, and that we don't necessarily put as much investment into mm-hmm. early childhood education like we need to, without realizing that the outcomes yeah. that we then see in adult life are very much shaped by what was going on at the age of zero yeah. to five.
I mean, one of my favorite people, he spoke to our employees at the Civil Rights Division when I first got there back in 09, was Freeman Hrabowski. You know, and if you look at the entering class at the Harvard Medical School every year and you look at the undergraduate institutions, UMBC is consistently in the top 10 mm-hmm. of undergraduate institutions where their students are matriculating to Harvard Medical School. And they're consistently students of color. Mm-hmm. He's built an ecosystem. That's the definition of success. When you've gotten to that critical mass, and when the word is out there that this place is happening, and I read about his successor, and I say, God bless you, because I would not want to follow Freeman Hrabowski.
But doing the work, absolutely. So then, thinking further about this with education, mm-hmm. one of the other questions that we had here is, teachers in the United States are frequently underpaid, especially those that do teach early childhood mm-hmm. education. How can we change this, and how can we incentivize going into the mm-hmm. teaching profession when many in the potential teacher pool have opted to pursue other careers? And will the effect of masking policies and debates yeah. and discussions about curricular content have an impact on those who would likely pursue a teaching career? And this is something that's like dear to my heart, because yeah. I have a little 3-year-old at home. And yeah, so yeah. Making sure his teachers have support is a big thing for us.
Well, yeah. I'm bringing it back to the blueprint. The blueprint understands this and recognizes this. So 40% of educators in Maryland leave within the first 5 years. That's a pre-pandemic statistic. I'm quite confident that that is moving up. 50% of our educators are imported. We are not generating enough. There is a major league disconnect between the racial demographic profile of our educators and the racial demographic profile of our students. There are so many teachers who are leaving because they're overwhelmed. We not only had a COVID crisis, you asked about masking, there's a mental health crisis mm-hmm. in Maryland that we have to address. If you look at Medicaid data right now, incidents of teenagers presenting in emergency rooms because they were suicidal is up like 40-50%. This is, these are startling data points. And, I think what we have to do as a state, and we have a $7.5 billion surplus right now, we need to be investing in building out a community mental health infrastructure, a community behavioral health infrastructure. We need to provide more supports. I'm confident if I were to speak to folks here on campus, the number of, the demand for, counseling services, I'm sure is increasing a lot. And we see this in the pre-K to 12 system. And so, a big thing that I think we could do right here that would really help is to partner with our 4 HBCUs mm-hmm. to really build out that pipeline. Shannon Sneed, who is my running mate in the governor's race, and we're not talking about politics here tonight, but what I love about Shannon is she's went to UMES undergrad, got a graduate degree at Morgan and taught at Coppin. And I think about that all the time because we need to do more as a state. I have 4 siblings and they're all doctors. And 2 of them had their med school paid for by the Public Health Service because I was a Pell Grant kid. Mm-hmm. Our dad died when I was a kid. And mm-hmm. Thank God for that. And we need to do more of that to make sure that we're producing an education profession, especially educators from underserved communities. And so we've got to have skin in the game as a state, because those are startling data points. 50% of our teachers are from somewhere else. 42% are leaving after within the first 5 years. I think half have another job, and I'm not talking about in the summer. I'm talking about waitering or waitressing on nights and weekends. That's not a sustainable trajectory. And that's why I so admire everybody involved in the blueprint, because this question is addressed front and center. And now we got to put our money where our mouth is and fund it and do it, because I think the most fundamental thing we do as a state is educate our workforce and produce people who are going to be remarkable leaders and citizens in our society. And this is a real challenge. And what's different about this and Thornton and all the other prior efforts is there's a implementation and accountability in the Kerwin framework. And we've really got to make sure we make that work so that we're not coming back 5 years later with another commission.
Absolutely, the follow through on this.
Yeah.
And I think it would be even further like a recruitment tool, yeah. right? To say to people that we are deliberately making this attempt to invest in educators yeah. for the future. And so that would definitely probably yield some benefits there. So our next question actually comes from somebody who has submitted online. This is Chikezi Maduka, and they ask, turning to the economics of a lot of this, mm-hmm. how can we overcome the inflation period we are in now?
Well, that's a challenging question, and it's important to take a step back and understand where we are now and where we were during the Great Recession. You know, the recovery has been at warp speed. When we hit this pandemic, you know, we saw massive job loss, and we are recovering. You know, based on the very aggressive investment in ARPA and in all the federal money, we were able to recover literally 8 years faster than we recovered during the Great Recession. So when I was your labor secretary, the thing that kept me up the most at night was the plight of the long-term unemployed. We did not have enough stimulus. We had as much stimulus as the politics permitted in 2009. It was about $800 billion. We have about four times that now. And the consequence of not having enough was that a lot of people waited years. And if you're 50 years old and you've been out of work now for 3 years, you've got a big, you have a scarlet letter. And I spent a ton of time working with the long-term unemployed. Why do I bring this up in response to your question? Mm-hmm. You know, when you inject this stimulus, you obviously have demand. And then when you have all the supply chain disruptions, you create a situation where we find ourselves in now. And obviously, the Fed is going to be a really important actor in attempting to bring down inflation. And I know the Biden administration is working very hard on the supply chain issues. And by the way, a person who worked on this campus has been a really important player in that, a guy named John Porcari. Who is very familiar to folks here at the College Park campus and was the former Deputy Secretary of Transportation. And he's been working with the administration. And so I think as you watch the Fed's action, as we solve these supply chain issues, and they're not going to be solved overnight, there's a host of forces. We've got to make more things in America, because part of the challenge is, you know, you've got container ships. If you go to the port of Los Angeles, you know, there, you know, a few months ago there were 70 container ships waiting to offload into Los Angeles. And so when the cost of a container goes up threefold, you know, you got to pass that through. Mm-hmm. And so I think that this is a moment in time where we have to understand that we need, when we make more things here, we put more people to work and we avoid situations like this. But again, the thing that I am heartened about is the pace of people getting back to work. Mm-hmm. The thing that I am heartened about is I don't have to lose sleep over the plight of the long-term unemployed. These are some of the trade-offs that were there. Now, it's very, $4 a gallon gas is very real. Mm-hmm. And if you are a low-wage worker who has to travel 20 miles to work there and back, you're eating up a lot of your salary. And there's no one more acutely aware of that than Joe Biden and other leaders, Republican and Democrat, right now.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And to that end, right, and you're speaking a bit about employment. And so we had another question that was submitted from L. Gay Hers that asked the question, what is the future of employment in the United States? We seem to have, quote unquote, full employment, but I know many people who cannot find jobs at a living wage. And I think this is particularly important, too, within this setting, right, because we have Gen Zs, young millennials, people who are going to be going out into the job market and looking for job prospects. You know, what kinds of things do they need to be thinking about with this, and where are we with employment in this country?
Yeah, well, I mean, our unemployment rate now, I think, is 3.6%. And again, when you, if we continue to create jobs at the pace we're creating them, and over the last 15 months, it's been about 500,000 jobs a month that have been coming back, we're going to be at pre-pandemic levels by the summertime, like, you know, July or August, something like that. That's remarkable. Your question is slightly different than that, because, you know, one of the most interesting things that's going on in the pandemic was that a lot of people who couldn't go to work took a step back, got off the dance floor and onto the balcony and said, you know, what do I want in life? And for a lot of folks, they said, I want more than what I'm getting now. I'm in a job that doesn't feed my family and it doesn't feed my soul. And what I think is remarkable about this moment is people demanding more. Mm-hmm. It's a tight labor market. And you know what? Workers have leverage. And workers are exercising that leverage. And we're seeing unionization efforts. I spoke two or three weeks ago to one of the people who organized the Starbucks in Buffalo, New York, which is, you know, where I grew up. And, you know, it's pretty remarkable. Now you're seeing Amazon. It's a matter of time. And what they were saying was, you know what, I want to be treated with dignity. And that's what it is. I mean, the dignity of work is the dignity of a good paycheck, but it's more than that. Mm-hmm. It's having ladders of upward mobility. It's having the ability to see your family. You know, there's no dignity in work when you're working three jobs. And one of the unfortunate things about our country right now is that we can't increase the federal minimum wage. That used to be a bipartisan thing. You know, after FDR enacted it, every president until Obama, every president, except I think one, had enacted an increase in the minimum wage. 7.25 an hour. Try living on that. Try living on $15 an hour. You know, the housing wage here, the wage that a family of four needs in our neck of the woods to just have a roof over your head. I'm not talking about, you know, big roof, but it's $29 an hour. That's what you need. And so, you know, what I think is remarkable about this moment is people are organizing and they're demanding more. And I think it's a remarkably healthy thing. And you're watching union organizing movements that are increasing. You're watching, you know, these things. And, you know, we have to really have a discussion about the future of work, because people like the flexibility that comes with controlling your own destiny. And we used to host events on the future of work. It's great to be able to control your hours, you know, the gig economy. The challenge with that is it's great to drive an Uber until you get in an accident and you need health care and you don't have it. And what are you going to do then? You're on a high wire without any sort of net. And there have been a number of really interesting experiments in how we create portable benefit systems and things like that. And in Maryland here, I'm really proud of the fact that we just passed a paid leave law. You know, we're the only industrialized nation on the planet that doesn't have some form of paid leave. And when I was your labor secretary, my colleague Valerie Jarrett and I led the president's lead on leave campaign. And I used to go and I'd say to people, you know, the United States and Papua New Guinea are the only industrialized nations on the earth that don't have some sort of paid leave. And someone stopped me after one of the speeches I gave, and he said, Papua New Guinea is about to pass a law. Stop dissing Papua New Guinea. So if anyone here is affiliated with Papua New Guinea, I want to apologize for inadvertently having disrespected the country. Mm. And that this is, And I've gone to Europe and Canada, and I talked to small businesses there, because we're not the only nation in the world that has small business. And I said, if you were king or queen for a day, would you get rid of your paid leave system? They looked at me like, are you crazy? This is part of our social compact. It's part of our effectiveness in increasing female labor force participation. It is part of who we are. I'd never get rid of it. Mm-hmm. And I just think we need to, this your question is a great question. The future of employment can be bright, but unfortunately, because of our inability to do anything in Washington, I think a lot of the innovation is going to occur at state levels. Because, you know, if there had been a 9/11 type incident, I don't even know that we could agree on a 9/11 commission.
That's an excellent point.
Don't mean to be dour, but, you know, this
I was told
to speak truth to power here, so.
You know. We appreciate it. And in thinking about this, because you spoke some about labor unions here, and if you wanted to elaborate further, because historically they've been played an important role in American politics. And, you know, even as an American politics professor, when we teach things like the American voter, one of the biggest things that used to be a predictor of people's electoral behavior was, well, what does the union say they're supposed to do? Mm-hmm. And that's who they would look to, right, as their lead or the heuristic to kind of inform them. And we are today in a space where we're seeing at least some rise in mm-hmm. unions. But, you know, where do we see things going in the future? And are there challenges or hurdles that are in place that prevent labor unions from really being able to get created or emerge?
Well, if you were to talk to Stuart Applebaum, who has been helping to lead the organizing efforts at Amazon, the Bessemer facility in Alabama, he would tell you, yeah, there's a heck of a lot of barriers. And that is, really illegal tactics that are used to scare people into submission. You know, when I was labor secretary, there was an organizing campaign in Chattanooga, Tennessee at the VW plant. VW is the biggest auto company in the world. They have all the different brands, Audi and boom, boom, boom. And I went to their headquarters in Germany and met with them. This was before all the fertilizer hit the windmill with their emissions stuff. They are unionized everywhere in the world. With the exception of the United States. And they have, in Germany, by statute, you have co-determination. And it's not just on wages and benefits, it's on governance. And during the Great Recession, their duration of the recession was far shorter because they were all in it together. And the union drive failed in Chattanooga because the governor and the senators threatened them with all sorts of things. And the former head of VW said, I didn't realize how challenging it would be to be in Tennessee. And I said, well, next time you might want to come to Maryland or something like that. I bring this up because I think it's, at the moment right now, I mean, if you look at public attitudes about the union movement, they were highest during the 50s. They were the lowest the union density hit its lowest in 2010. 1981 for labor historians was a bad year. That was the PATCO, when President Reagan broke the PATCO union. And his goal there was not just to break that union, his goal there was to send a message that it's open season on the labor movement. Attitudes about labor movement right now are as high, almost as high as they've been since the 50s. I think 67% of the American people have remembered now that the labor movement brought us the weekend. And it's really interesting to watch. And I'm always, we used to do conferences on what we called worker voice. I'm a firm believer that when you can build a culture where workers have a meaningful voice and a meaningful seat at the table, you can overcome a great recession or a pandemic, because when you're all in it together, that's the way it works. And I am bullish about the future. I do think this pandemic has, the subsequent tight labor market is giving the movement opportunities, and I think it's a wonderful thing.
Absolutely. More people embracing this idea that they can collectivize and work together to try to get better outcomes in the workspace. Yep. For sure, for sure. And so now, in thinking about some other pieces to this discussion, I wanted to move to voting rights, because this has been a very debated thing. And as the John Lewis Voting Rights Act remains stalled in the U.S. Senate, and many states across the country continue to pass legislation that make it more difficult to vote, what is the same and what is different in a historical and political context about what is going on, and as it pertains to the fight for voting rights in the United States?
This is my worst day in the Obama administration occurred in 2013. Shortly before, I was running the Civil Rights Division at that point. I transitioned to Labor Secretary, I think, in July of 2013. And in June of that year, that's when the Supreme Court issued the decision in Shelby County, which neutered the guts of the Voting Rights Act. And it was a decision in which the Chief Justice Roberts said that effectively discrimination, it's a new day in America, and we don't need the benefits, the prophylactic benefits of Section 5. And all I can do is tell you, now if I had this bottle and handed it to you in Georgia, I would be subject to a one-year misdemeanor prosecution because you were in line getting ready to vote. Section 5, for those of you who don't know what it was passed in 1965, reauthorized, and in 2007 reauthorized by the Republicans. There was not a single senator who voted against the reauthorization in 2007, and only a dozen or two House members who voted against reauthorization. And in 2007, we know the president was a guy named George W. Bush. There was consensus around this. And there was a voluminous record. And the record showed that there were states that engaged in systematic, pernicious practices of making it next to impossible for people of color to vote. And it is really important. And the elimination of that meant it was open season. The Texas voter ID law, that was one of the cases we litigated, struck down under Section 5. What happened after Shelby County? Guess what? They reenacted it. I could give you example after example after example. And here's the thing that's so ironic. If we were having an honest conversation about the 2020 election, we should have a bipartisan celebration right now. Because what happened in 2020? In a pandemic, we had record voter turnout, the highest voter turnout in our history. And guess what? It helped Joe Biden win the presidency. But I'll tell you, I was talking with Speaker Pelosi. I was at the DNC at this point. I was talking with her regularly, and we were having conversations. What's the range? How are we going to do in the House? I'll be candid with you. You know, the range was, we'll pick up 5 seats, maybe pick up 15 or 20. That was our range. We never had a discussion about we're going to be net negative 13. How did that happen? Didn't happen because the Republicans cheated in Texas. Donald Trump was a turnout machine. Joe Biden got the most votes in American history. Donald Trump got the second most votes in American history. That's what I mean when I say we should have a bipartisan celebration. We flipped the White House, we flipped the Senate, we flipped the House. But, you know, they positioned themselves so that the House is very much up for grabs in 2022. I don't think I'm giving away state secrets by saying that. And so that's what is so annoying about the insurrection. Annoying is a way too polite word, but I the words that are coming to mind are not fit for publication. We have to take a step back here. And the reason, I have a number of reasons why we have to eliminate the filibuster. This is the number one reason, because the filibuster has been used to disenfranchise communities of color. Mm-hmm. And so I'm focused very much on trying. We need to be +2 in the Senate after November, and we need to still have the House. And I say plus two, because there's two Democratic senators that aren't going to change the filibuster rule. And we need to do it. And this is the only way we're going to get there. And in the meantime, you know, states like Maryland and others where we don't have craziness, you know, we need to make sure that it's as easy as possible for eligible people to vote. And then we need to make sure that those votes are counted. People ask, when's Election Day? And my answer to that is always, the election ends on July 19th. Because we want to remind people, especially, like, if you're picking a day to vote to have an election, like the almost precise middle of the summer, not exactly the perfect day you'd pick, but that's fine. You know, it's a level playing field for everyone. But what we have to do is make sure that people exercise that right. And what's so inspiring about 2017, we had record turnout in that year. 2018, we had the highest turnout in the midterm since the 60s, since the Civil Rights Movement. 2019, if you go to Kentucky, they had 600,000 more voters than they had in 2015 in their gubernatorial race. That's how Andy Beshear won. And in 2020, we've just discussed. Let's have a debate in the marketplace of ideas about whether we should have paid leave or whether we should have these issues, whether we should raise the minimum wage, and then let's make it as easy as possible for eligible people to vote. I don't know why they're so scared of big turnout, because big turnout helped them in a lot of races. That's what's the most confusing thing. One of the myths about politics at a presidential level especially, but at a number of levels, is that large turnout will always help Democrats. I can give you way too many examples of that not being the case. They shouldn't be afraid of people turning out.
That's an excellent point. And in fact, just to play a little bit of a devil's advocate to what you've been saying.
Good.
You know, so we noted to the Shelby v. Holder decision, and you discussed, you know, the ramifications of that with respect to then the Voting Rights Act protections and the preclearances. So then if we're having higher voter turnout despite the Shelby decision, would someone argue, well, see, then we don't need to worry about protecting people's voting rights in the way that you're talking about it, because people will turn out and vote, and they'll make sure they do it in the way that their votes are real votes, like they're true votes, they're not these fake votes that some people seem to claim are occurring, right, that there's some invalidation of votes.
Well, I tried in the Texas voter ID case, and I don't have precision on this because I haven't looked at the record in a dozen years, but I'm not far off. The record evidence in that case, this was a case that was tried in 2011 or 2012, pre-Shelby County. The record evidence was that over the course of something like 8 million votes cast, there were something like four instances of in-person voter fraud. And I think there were two incidents of a similar kind of fraud out of, you know, 8 million cast. I mean, you have a higher probability of getting struck by lightning. And so, I mean, these are solutions to non-existent challenges. Mm. And you know, the other more contemporary response I would give is look at the record in Georgia in some of these most recent elections with some of these new barriers, and you look at the rejection rate, I'm sorry, Texas, in the primary that just took place, the number of ballots that were rejected because of the new provisions they put in place was off the charts. And that is unconscionable. And, you know, I just don't know that this court is going to give a damn. I mean, that's really, and it's, by the way, just to be clear, it's not the Roberts Court anymore. It's the Thomas Court. I mean, that's the scariest thing of all. I mean, you know, if those of you who go to law school, one of the worst insults you can hurl at a Supreme Court is to say, you're worse than the Lochner Court. You know, the Lochner decision, the famous Lochner decision of, I think it was 1914, which basically, you know, there was a New York law that tried to regulate conditions in, I think it was bakeries, and the court basically said, you know, you can't do that. You know, you should, you know, if you can go work and get lung cancer in the whole nine yards, and, you know, don't regulate. That's the worst insult that you can hurl. This court is going to make the Lochner Court look like the Warren Court. And I say that with great sadness and great madness.
It's something to think about there.
That's why we need term limits for Supreme Court justices. We're one of the only countries in the world that does it this way. And the average tenure of a Supreme Court justice right now is the longest it's been in American history.
Do you have a time frame in mind when you say term limits?
One of the bills had 18 years, I think.
Okay.
There's a commission that has been studying this. Mm-hmm. And a number of very learned folks have put together a pretty compelling report, but it's going to take a while. If we can't, you know, we have trouble renaming post offices right mm-hmm. now. So, it's going to take a little while to get to this. But again, you got to keep banging the drum, because I really think that, the public opinion of the Supreme Court has declined precipitously mm-hmm. in recent years. And Justice Chief Justice Roberts, he understands that. I mean, the legitimacy of the court. There's this old saying, we are a nation of laws and not of men and women. That doesn't look that way right now. Mm-hmm. And I think the judge that just struck down the mask mandate in Florida was the last appointee of Trump, mm-hmm. Declared unqualified by the ABA. I think like 4 years out of law school or 5 years out of law school was, and I don't want to have age discrimination. I think that's wonderful to have people of all ages on the bench. Mm-hmm. I think she was 32 years old or 33 years old. Clearly, we're going to have this for years to come. And that's why we public confidence in the Supreme Court is at a low ebb, and it's not hard to figure out why.
So one of our final questions that I'll go ahead and ask is from our submitted online, Ryan Frazier asked, Maryland, along with other states such as Massachusetts, has a history of electing Republican governors alongside heavy Democratic majorities in the state house. As a Democratic candidate for governor, what does this tell you about the political attitudes existing in the state?
Well, it tells me that we have to organize every year, everywhere, and we have to lead with our values. In 2018, when I was DNC chair, we actually flipped eight governor seats from red to blue in places like Kansas. What's the matter with Kansas? Not a darn thing. They elected Laura Kelly. They elected Sharice Davids. A mixed martial artist, gay Native American woman, and a rock star. And she was judged by the content of her character, the quality of her presentation, and her vision. And I think what we have to do here, in Maryland, I think Democrats fell into traps that you should never fall into. You don't have to organize in all 23 jurisdictions in the city of Baltimore. You can just go to the big places, Baltimore, Prince George's County, Montgomery County, and then call it a day. Mm-hmm. That's not only a politically stupid strategy, it's morally bankrupt. Mm-hmm. You're not the governor for blue counties, you're the governor of Maryland. And that's what you have to do. And there's so many issues. We're so divided as a nation, but there's so many issues here in Maryland that can bring us together. Education reform shouldn't be a Republican or a Democratic issue. That's an imperative for all of us if we're going to move forward. We have a climate crisis right now, and we should become the offshore wind capital of the United States, but we've underperformed in that area. Massachusetts just got approved for 4,000 megawatts of offshore wind. Charlie Baker. But we've underperformed here. We have an opioid crisis. That's not a crisis for Republicans or Democrats. If I asked a show of hands, who's been personally impacted by the opioid epidemic, I would be the first to raise my hand. And I can't talk about the details because I can't get through it without, having serious, it touches us all. And I think when you have a governor who can speak to people's hopes and dreams and wishes and And, you know, governor's the chief executive officer of a complex organization. And people want a governor to make sure that their lives can be improved. If, God forbid, you lose your job, you don't wait 7 months for your unemployment check, mm-hmm. which is what happened over this pandemic. A governor who can make sure that we can all get access to health care. You know, Mitt Romney, I give him credit. When he was governor of Massachusetts, he brought us the model for how we got to the Affordable Care Act. In the Affordable Care Act, we have 20 million less uninsured because of the ACA. And, you know, I have a plan to take, we went from 1 million uninsured to 375,000 uninsured in Maryland. And I have a plan to take us to zero. Why is that important? We got to learn from the pandemic. 25% of COVID deaths were a function of the fact that we still have 375,000 uninsured Marylanders. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, again, that question, I think when people, when we affirmatively talk about a vision that is a vision that I think is not a Republican vision or a Democratic vision. It wasn't Republicans or Democrats alone that died because they were uninsured. It was, you know, that's not how it works. And so, you know, I love that question. And, you know, we've had only one Democrat elected governor in the 21st century in Maryland. So it's a very fair question to ask. But I think when you organize early, when you organize everywhere, when you speak to people's hopes, understand their fears. And one thing I've learned is that Marylanders want a governor who can get the job done. You know, I often refer to myself as the charter member of the GSD wing of the Democratic Party because I want to get stuff done. And, you know, the governor needs to be a multitasker, especially now, because people's problems aren't siloed. Oh, I just education. I mean, we got kids who are waking up hungry. A parent may be opioid addicted, or they've lost their job, they're housing insecure, and they're going to school, and we're wondering why they're low performing. That's not a hard question to answer. There is an interrelatedness to all of these challenges. Mm-hmm. And I think when you can, you know, when you have someone who, you know, has that experience and track record to get things done, you can do it. And, you know, I think Marylanders want jobs, justice, and opportunity right now. I think they want someone who can get stuff done. Mm-hmm. And I don't know about you, but I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. It's hard to watch what happens in Washington some days where you just can't agree on anything. And what I love about state government is that you can't print money. You got to solve problems. You know, when I was on the Montgomery County Council, we had 8 Democrats and 1 Republican. And the person I worked as closely with as anyone was our 1 Republican. Because so many of the issues just weren't, you know, it wasn't Hatfield-McCoy. Mm-hmm. And I learned from Ted Kennedy again, that search for common ground. And I end where I started because I really want students, you know, we're not, grown-ups are not modeling well right now. Mm-hmm. And I urge you to seek out people that maybe and may have a different opinion than you on something and try and work through it. You know, we had 45,000 Verizon workers on strike when I was labor secretary from Maine down to Virginia. And it was ugly. They weren't talking. They just cut off health insurance. There were people who had, who were getting chemotherapy that their treatment was being cut off. I had no authority to settle the strike. You know, I couldn't say, go back to work. That's not how it works. But I was losing sleep over it because it was just getting rough. So I picked up the phone. I called 3 people. I called the CEO, and I called the 2 union heads. I invited them to my office. And I said, my goal is to see if we can get back to the table. And if the answer is no, come to my office Sunday. If the answer is no, I'll never tell anyone we met. They came. They agreed to come back to the table. I suggested we do it at the Labor Department. We started 2 days later. I told them a week from Friday is my middle school, my middle kid's high school graduation from Blair High School. I'm darn well going to be there. It's at 2 p.m. I was a kid when my dad died. He wasn't at my 8th grade graduation. He wasn't at my high school graduation. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be there. And 2 hours before graduation, we announced our settlement. I had time to get lunch.
Yeah.
But I bring that up because We live in a world of false choices as well. Mm-hmm. You're either on the union side or you're on the management side. Mm-hmm. Who did we help there? We helped the workers. And by the way, they extended the contract 4 years later. They still have labor peace from this contract from 2016. You know, we helped workers, we helped management, we helped shareholders, we helped customers. We got to live in a world where we reject false choices. Are you on the police's side or are you on the community side? I did a lot of work in the police context, in the police reform context. That is a false choice. We have a crime problem, and I know one of the questions we didn't get to was about how do you deal with crime. Well, the most important tool that a police officer has in her arsenal to fight crime is the trust of the community. In all the cases I went into, whether it was New Orleans or Seattle, some places where departments were really broken, we had to restore that trust. Because when you have trust, they are your eyes and ears, the community. And I can show you, it's not easy. And rebuilding the Baltimore Police Department won't be easy. But you know what? It really is remarkable when it happens. And it can happen. And I don't want you to leave this lecture tonight feeling hangdog. Because, you know, this is not the first time in our nation's journey to form a more perfect union that we've been, you know, in a ditch. You know, McCarthyism didn't end the day after Joe McCarthy got censored. You know, the know-nothing movement of the mid-19th century wasn't an on-off switch. And Trumpism predated Trump. And it postdates Trump. And, you know, the arc of the moral universe, as Dr. King said, is long, but it does bend toward justice. Mm. But it never bends on its own. And we need more young people to continue to help bend that arc. I love what y'all do on climate. And your activism. I love what you do on, racial equity. And God knows, this state, we've got a lot of racial inequity. We're the richest state in the country. We have the highest incarceration rate of black men. We have unconscionable maternal infant mortality rates, disparities. We got a lot of stuff we need to do. We have generational poverty that's white and non-white. Mm-hmm. And we've got the richest state in the country. If we can't do it, then shame on us. And that's what we've got to do together. And this institution, and I'm so grateful for your sponsoring this and for your longstanding leadership here. I moved here in the late 80s. This university, man, I look at it today, it's cooking. And it is wonderful having folks like you. But I hope that some of you folks, and I coached a kid in basketball for a number of years who's in this room, and he's a really good basketball player, but much more importantly, hi Isaiah, sorry about that. He is a remarkable leader in the making, and you know, I want you all to be part of the solution, because we can do this, and the reason we were able to turn it around in other decades and other moments is because people stood up, and that's what we're going to do now. And you can do it at a local level. You can do it at a state level. You can do it at a federal level. You know, I worked in all three levels of government. Couldn't hold a job. So was at all of them. And that's what I want you all to do. Because these are scary times. But in times like this, that's when you write and you rewrite the social compact. Absolutely. What were the two most tumultuous decades of the 20th century? The 30s and the 60s. Where did we have the most enduring parts of our social compact? Laws that I had the privilege of enforcing at the Labor Department, the 30s, at the Civil Rights Division, the 60s. We're in one of these moments now, moments of incredible opportunity, and we can never forget that. I'm not.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, thank you for coming this evening. It's been a pleasure. And speaking greatness into our young people here, we are going to wrap up for the night. So thank you all for attending this evening. And, well, I'm sure we'll see you out there doing more work.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much. I'd love to come to your class.